partner drills, right? And I deal with one other person that you're working with. In every drill that we do, there are two roles to facilitate, okay? Those roles are the trainee and the trainer. For the purpose of a drill, this has nothing to do with who is the more experienced fighter. These are simply roles that need to be facilitated. We need to understand how we do each of these drills, what the purpose is for the trainee and for the trainer. For the purpose of this drill, this is what I call the 2-second drill. This is the one drill that I teach that people have told me is the most useful to them and the most adequate. Okay? This is primarily a recovery drill. It's primarily an offensive recovery drill. Okay? As you might remember from when I talked to class yesterday and when I was sitting on the side, the offensive recovery is the single greatest failure in our school. The one thing that people fail the most often to do. Oddly enough, it's also one of the easiest things to fix. And by fixing recovery, we will coincidentally fix a number of other sins, particularly sitting pants, kind of better delivery pants. Okay? So the idea of recovery is wherever you start your shot from, each and every shot you throw after that needs to get back to the starting point. Okay? I teach facing sitting pants from the shoulder. So all of my shots are going to get some way through my shoulder. Eventually you'll get to the point where it goes through a shoulder. It doesn't necessarily have to be the sore shoulder. If I get something on the outside, I come back here, we're going to go around right after that, I can still come through the shoulder. And the part of the state that really needs to recover is the supervisor. That's the part that we're going to do the most damage, right? So this is primarily a recovery drill. So a couple of problems that we have at both ends of the fighting spectrum. For weaker fighters, a lot of weaker fighters don't throw frequently enough. They don't throw enough shots because they think that they can't get to a particular target. Okay, you're basically looking for a target that's this big. You kind of have to exist, you know, anywhere in the sport. And you miss 100% of the shots that you don't throw. So newer fighters have a tendency to not throw shots because they feel like they can't get to them because their targeting isn't good enough, right? The more you throw at the less perfect targets, the smaller your target zone becomes. Okay? And again, when I was talking yesterday about victory conditions, this is exactly what I was talking about, where if you see a valid target, if you throw a good hand at a valid target, and your opponent blocks that shot, that doesn't negate the fact that you've thrown a good mechanic at a valid target, and you need to consider that a success, even if it doesn't end up getting killed. Makes sense. Mm-hmm. Well, the newer fighters are looking for these giant targets, right? How much target do you need?
That much?
Inch and a quarter. Right? For me, the blade marking on my sit is about a half inch of the table. So if you do that much, I'll go with the rest of it. And an inch and a quarter, right? So if you see an inch and a quarter of legal target anywhere, just take a shot at it. Okay? So the first part of this drill addresses firing more frequently. And as you fire more frequently, the less concern about whether or not you're going to be able to get to that target. I'm not talking about compromising the quality of the blow. You want to throw it as good of a blow as you can. But you just need to be less concerned about whether or not that blow is actually going to strike the target. Okay? Okay, there's a concept that's right there. Let's go. So, inch and a quarter. If you see an inch and a quarter of it, you're just going to take a shot at it. And so, this is about the drill is about frequency of blows. So, for that beginning fighter, we're looking to be firing more frequently. So, we're looking for at least once every 2 seconds. Okay? Maybe less than a second. On the other end of the firing spectrum, this drill addresses is that fighter that just wants to throw as much as they can. They're going to throw as much lead down range and hope that something is going to stick. Okay? So, remember, I was talking yesterday, there are two parts to recovery. There's a physical recovery, we're getting the shit back to the starting point, and then there's the target recognition friend who wants to throw more shots, hoping that something is going to get through, probably has enough stick mechanics on those.
So there's something that does come through that it's going to hit. But they're missing the critical part of getting that part of the recognition.
Again, when you take that extra time, and we were talking about half a heartbeat of extra time that it's going to take for you to complete the recovery and make better decisions.
When you make better decisions about the load that you're throwing, the resources you need to deliver the throwing load are inherently present
in ways they are not when you are trying to force them through. Make sense? And when you get used to this concept, this again is what is going to slow down your life. So you're forcing yourself to take that time. And when you take that time to actually see what's happening in the fight, you're going to be amazed at the targets that you can see and what is how much better you can see what is actually happening in the fight instead of what you want to happen in the fight, what you hope is going to happen in the fight. Does that make sense? Any questions so far? Okay. So the other end of this, drill for the resilient fighters, we want to make fire lesser. Right. So the frequency of most of this drill is at least once every 2 seconds, but not more than twice in 1 second. Okay. At least once every 2 seconds. That addresses the zero fire that doesn't take out those fighters that don't want to throw those newer fighters that don't think they can get to a target. Basically, what you end up doing is you end up spending that time convincing yourself that you can't go to that shot. And what happens is if you throw at whatever frequency is less than a third, or whether or not you can actually hit the target, you're going to find that your mechanics are actually far better than you think that they are. And you're actually going to hit a lot more of these shots than you thought possible because you're not taking the time to convince yourself that you can't. Make sense? That was a thought that I had to disappear. Okay, so at least once every 2 seconds, not more than twice in 1 second. Any questions about that? Okay, so we're going to have this side of the room to start with is going to be trained birds. And this side of the room is going to be the trained E. Okay? The job of the trained E is going to be you're going to fire 15 shots at a frequency of at least once every 2 seconds, but not more than twice in 1 second. For the purpose of this drill, your hand has to get back to the starting position, right? There are plenty of things that we do that are perfectly valid for us to come off of one shot and go to another shot. However, for the purpose of this drill, because you're trying to encourage target recognition and making those decisions, we need to complete one shot, put the hand back to the shoulder, and then fire another shot out of that. Does that make sense? If you come off of one shot and you roll immediately into another shot, that needs to be considered a failure of the drill. Make sense?
Totally forgot about that. Okay.
You create an environment where it is safe for us to fail. Okay. Well, we're going to offer that. Okay. So what we're going to do is that this is just going to be passing, and for the most part, as we're assigning targets, we're basically going to be, you're going to be, most of us are going to be in a direction of the target you see. Does that make sense? So I'm going to initiate first and then turn the key. Essentially, what this is designing on this basically just becomes
question, as you were doing the mines, people in there too, he said, and then you go back to the guard.
Yeah.
Even when you're messing around, when you go back to the guard, when you go through the guard, you're like, you are under real estate in the airport.
I'm
going to
lie to you. I put my glass up.
Thank you.
the same is like, oh, yeah, I'm going to block that right there. Meanwhile, he's continuing to bite. Right. After you're like, here we are. Yeah. I have blocked your shot. And he's still running around it, right? That's a product of, like, you did what you're supposed to do, and that was so we can have awareness of what's going on, right? So as I'm delivering a blow, I'm looking for what's going to happen, right? And as I complete that blow, now I don't need to tell my hand how to get back to my shoulder cover, right? It should be just non-active response to get back there. We'll leave mental capacity available for doing target recognition after that, right? So essentially, as it's going out, it's blow recognition, target recognition, blow recognition, target recognition. What is coming at me? If I need to block that, I can block it. What is available to me? What is coming at me? What is available to me? Does that make sense? Yeah, I work through that as you're doing this and kind of keep those things in mind as well. And that's why, again, this is primarily a recovery drill. Part of that recovery is target recognition. You can also do blow recognition as well. As the train occurred, you can also do as you're doing this, and as your opponent is just throwing shots out there, as the train occurred, you can also use this for your own purposes to catalog blows. And yes, you are providing blows for them where they want to go, but at the same time, you can, as they hit, depending on you give them a target, they may or may not go for it. But you can still do upper left, you know, up, down, left, right, you can catalog. This is a drill you can use for a wide variety of things, both as a game trainer and training. Okay, so if you haven't already, there are description rules. So, same partner, training is now the trainer.
full time.
He can't count.
Yeah, I didn't stay static last time I was out of the locker room.
Who's coming?
Yeah, you go, because I got to work on the stage.
Thank you.
training, but I'm going to go through just a little bit of the training process and kind of show you what it looks like in Michigan. Understanding that this process is something that typically takes up to 3 months to really kind of come to fruition, right? And that's why Crown Attorney is one of the, not necessarily the best evaluation, but it is the most consistent evaluation. If you're entering Crown Attorney on a regular basis, every 6 months, you go to Crown, find out one of your deficiencies, you start working that out, and over the course of 6 months, you get another opportunity to go on the ground, and ideally what happens is, whether you win more fights or not, now you're not losing for the same reasons that you had lost before, right? And just being able to kind of chip away at that, and what happens is you've made an improvement on one thing, and then ideally you have now exposed the next greatest deficiency in your fight. Work on that. At the same time, you can still be working on the same improvements on it. Right? And then that cycle just kind of continues to happen.
Two grand on one setup. So, more which I thought was a pretty great example where you're talking about. You're still making mistakes, obviously, but you're making a different one from last time. Yeah,
that is it. Slow progress is progress, right? And yeah, you're still getting good enough at pain. Making improvements in your fight and having progress in your fight does not necessarily mean short term. Does not necessarily lead to more victories in term. But as you continue to chip away at those deficiencies, it does. And eventually it just kind of builds up. One of the things about tournament is one of the things I say about how well you do in a list. Tournament is like the stock market. In the stock market, they say, past performance is no indicator of future returns. Right? Just because you go to the semifinals and crown doesn't mean you can't come to the next one. Right? So don't get too wrapped up in, I did really well on this list. I did really well. Sure, you went further in this list, but have you improved as a fighter? And body count is not strictly, body count alone does not indicate that. So we have to there are other ways to measure progress, and sometimes that progress just comes from somebody like Randall saying, you're dying with other stuff, and that's an improvement. Sometimes that's the takeaway you get. So,